Thank you, go ahead. Sarah speaks better in that one than I do. Toyet, Lenin, son. A shame, but a shame out of Torah chain, that's not. Poor Hanay, that's a tree. Who's Toyet, Lenin here? There you go, future leaders. Toyet, Lenin, not Anido, Lacha. Future leaders in here. Our traditional ancestral area, Toyet, Lenin is over there, Pagosa Springs. The rivers are run past Pagosa Springs where they have those hot springs, and then there's another river that comes out. They used to meet right there, what is called Navajo Dam. In the old days, long time ago, my grandma said that our Navajo medicine men used to go there and do their ceremonies, do offerings and all that right there where the rivers came together. But now it's all flooded. It's a huge dam there. So probably not possible to do any more offerings. Anyway, I've been here all day. I started this morning, spoke to some of the students here in Sarah's class. And then after that, then we did a roundtable discussion on Navajo sovereignty. Professor Lee from UNM, and then also Bittop Becker from Window Rock, she's an attorney. So we talked about Navajo sovereignty, and some of you were there. And then I had this talk this afternoon, so we were treated very well. Myself and my wife, she's sitting there, Diane. We've been treated very well here at Dunant College, and we want to thank you for that. You've been very good hosts here. After I got down here, going back to my sheep camp, I got to take my sheep out in the morning. Anyway, I haven't asked to talk here about any topic, and I think probably the one topic that you should know about, and maybe some of you already know about, is the Navajo courts. Navajo Nation court system, and also Navajo peacemaking. When we talk about the Navajo courts and Navajo government itself, we have to go back in history. We have to go back all the way back several years, but I'm not going to go all the way back to Columbus. What we can do is we can start with the Bureau of Indian Affairs and what they were doing and the federal policies that they were pushing and promoting around about early 1800s. Really, this is something that started around about the 1860s. If you know anything about federal Indian policies and how the federal government deals with Indian tribes, you may have heard of what is called assimilation. Now, assimilation could mean that, you know, we could have a group of people here, Europeans coming over, and then you have the indigenous peoples or Indians over here, and then they come together, and then they share things and all that. Anyway, we all become one big happy family. That's usually what people think of when they talk about assimilation or when they think about assimilation. But that is not how things happen in this country. And it still hasn't happened for Indian people right now. But assimilation is behind a lot of the policies that the federal government has for Indian peoples. And the courts that came out in 1883, the courts that the Bureau of Indian Affairs came up with, created rules for them, and imposed, forced on Indian tribes across the country is part of that concept of assimilation. Now, when we talk about assimilation, the real underlying idea, the underlying concept for that, of course, is this thing called civilizing the American Indians, civilization. The Europeans thought of Indian people, and of course, what we call the founding fathers. They saw Indian peoples as uncivilized savages, heathens. And you read the document here, you can see much of that in there. For rules governing the court of Indian offenses, they have it in there. And that was the underlying idea why the Indian peoples were uncivilized. They were heathens, non-Christians. You know, their occupation was war, all this type of stuff, all the negative stuff that you hear about people, about Indian people that the Europeans had, savages and all that. And so the thing was, the European discoverers and also United States, after it became a nation, imposed a duty on itself to civilize the Indians. But it is civilize the Indians and Christianize the Indians. Now, how do you go about doing that? The question that was debated at the time. And here it is, what they did is they said, we can civilize the Indians using certain methods, certain tools. One of them, of course, is the Federal Indian Boarding School System. Federal Indian Boarding School System, where you took kids from reservations and shipped them as far away from their families as possible. So they took Indian kids from reservations in the West, and of course you heard about Carlisle Indian School. So they shipped them over there, sent them over there, and kept them over there for years without them ever coming back to see their families. And a lot of the kids died over there at Carlisle. And then that was one tool. And later on, of course, the federal boarding school system came to Indian country, and we had a number of them here all across the Navajo Nation. I'm a proud of that federal Indian boarding school system. That's where I started my education when I was a kid. Anyway, so that was one of them. And the whole purpose behind this civilizing thing, of course, is to strip Indian peoples of their cultures, strip them of their languages, strip them of their religions, strip them of their identities, and remake them into Americans, remake them into white people. That's what it was. Replace their religions, traditional religions, with Christianity. And if you ever hear your grandparents talk about a BIA boarding school system, of course, the first Sunday you're at school, you're required to go to some church. Churches there. The first Sunday, all these people from different churches would come to the school. And then, you have people who are Catholics, Protestants, all these different churches, and then they take the kids to those churches. If you are like me, you're a little savage, you came out of the boonies out of nowhere, like me, you didn't have a church, none, because you grew up traditional, all your religious training was through medicine men. My grandparents and my grandma and her brothers were all medicine men. And so there it is, a few of us standing there, we didn't have a church to go to. And so what they do is, you go down the line and say, okay, you're going to be Catholic, you're going to be LDS, you're going to be Protestant, you're going to be this church. That's how I turned into a Catholic. So that's how it is. And of course, Christian indoctrination was part of this assimilation process. And so that was the federal boarding school system. The second method that they use to civilize the Indians, of course, is this, the Courts of Indian Offenses. The Bureau of Indian Affairs drafted rules, regulations for the Courts of Indian Offenses. The Courts of Indian Offenses was modeled on the American version of court system, the adversarial system is what we call it. So they came up with these rules, and of course you can see the letter that was written by the Secretary of the Interior. This was written on December 2nd, 1882, and sent to the Indian Commissioner, the Commissioner of Indian Affairs, and you can read it for yourself. What people in government, the federal government, the officials, all the way from the president on down, the congressmen, senators, people who are in the House of Representatives, the judges, all of them, people in the federal government, thought about Indian people, and it's all right in there. It tells you about that. How they call the Indian people uncivilized, people in need of civilizing and all that. So they came up with all that, and this went to the Commissioner of Indian Affairs, who had charge of the Bureau of Indian Affairs. So they came up with these rules, the you read through them, I would urge you to read it several times, because what these rules do is they basically outlaw you as an Indian person. They outlaw your culture, they outlaw your religion, they outlaw just about everything having to do with being an Indian person on the reservation at the time. So these came out. So that was the second method, and I'll come back to this in a while. But that's the second method. The third method that they use to forcibly assimilate Indian people is what is called the General Allotment Act, sometimes called the Dawes Act, and they came out in about 1882. After Indian peoples were placed on reservations across the country, then of course, you know, white people saw some lands that were looked pretty good, fertile lands, you know, pasture lands, some lands that could be used for farming and all that. And so what they did was they went to Congress, imposed on Congress, persuaded Congress to pass what is called the General Allotment Act. And this General Allotment Act, what it did is it broke up reservation lands, the lands that were promised to the Indian people in treaties, the treaties that they made. And so what they did is they broke up these reservation lands into about 160-acre parcels, most of them 160-acre parcels that were allotted to Indian heads of households. Of course, if you were single, you may have gotten an 80-acre parcel or a 60-acre parcel, whatever it is. But that's what they did, is they chopped up these reservation lands into allotments. We have a number of allotments over there on the New Mexico side of the Navajo Nation. Of course, there's some allotments near on that side also, on the Arizona side. But that's what they did, is they chop up these reservation lands and then assign them as private property. Private property to individual heads of household. Now the idea of property, Western ideas of property, is it's a part of civilization. If you are civilized, then you own property. You own title to a tract of land. See, so that's how it was. So the idea was to turn the Indian peoples into property owners. Get them away from all this business about family, cat and relatives and all that stuff, you know, and turn them into individualized people. Individualized thinking, property owners. So that is what was used. And the land that was not allotted, these reservation lands that were not allotted to Indian people, were then open to public settlement. That's where non-Indians came in and they bought up these lands that used to be former reservation lands. That's the reason why today you go to some Indian reservations and you'll find more non-Indians living on those reservations than there are Indians. You'll find more non-Indians, white people, owning land on those reservations than Indian trust lands. So that is one of the products of the General Allotment Act, and it causes great jurisdictional problems today. Law enforcement people don't know, they have to first determine what the land is, the status of the land. They're investigating a crime. Is that trust land? Is that allotment land? Is that private land? Is that state land? All that they have to go through that before they can determine who has jurisdiction to investigate that crime. And that is a major problem today. And I'll tell you about how we're addressing that at NAU later on, if I can remember it. Anyway, so that is another tool that was used to civilize the Indians. Of course, all of this was supposed to take place on an Indian reservation. Indian reservations are set up there where, you know, your land and all that. There's a federal court decision that came out later in about 1888, which said that reservation lands are simply nothing more than areas like schools. They're schools. And the Indians are gathered on there on these reservations so that they can be taught the habits of civilization, so they can be civilized on those reservations, is what the court decision said. So that's the reason why, you know, that is probably the thinking of the time, what what the federal judge and all that, they thought about Indian people at the time, that you are on these reservations, not necessarily become productive citizens, but for you to be schooled in the arts of civilization. So that's what it said. That's what the court decision said. Okay, those three tools were used on a course, you know, you study civilization, for civilization, and other federal Indian policies that predated this, like the Indian Removal Acts and all that, tribes being removed to the reservations from different areas, all of these, and all the way up to through the 1950s and what is called the Indian Termination Acts. All that, you look at all these federal policies and you'll find that most of them did tremendous damage to Indian peoples and to Indian tribes, to Indian property holdings, land and all that. And you know, a lot of these things that happened to Indian people through these federal policies over the course of over 200 years, the consequences, the results of it is what you see today. You say here about Indian people, you know, having the highest rates of this or that, you know, highest rates of alcoholism, drug abuse, all this type of stuff, social problems, health problems, all these things that people talk about today that are statistics where Indian people have the worst of anything. Those are the products of all these federal Indian policies, everything that happened to Indian people over the course of over 200 years. So, if you can understand all those, then you can understand what this is about. Now, in 1883, of course, the Bureau of Indian Affairs came up with the rules for the courts of Indian offenses. The courts of Indian offenses are also called CFR courts because they operate under what is called the Code of Federal Regulations. So there you have the courts of Indian offenses established in 1883. Then the idea was to plant these courts on different reservations across the country. About 1886, somewhere around there, is when they started these courts in different parts of the country. The Navajo Nation, Navajo people got their courts of Indian offenses in 1892. One was placed here on the Navajo Nation in 1892. And then, of course, the laws that they applied or set out in here, the original laws, the criminal code that came out for these courts to enforce, they were all in here, and you can read them yourself. I'll tell you a little bit on some of them. Of course, if you look at right under there where it says rules, there on number 4, it says, the sun dance, the scalp dance, the war dance, and so-called feasts shall be considered Indian offenses. So this basically is talking about, you know, tribes holding potlucks or family get-togethers for ceremonies, all these things, feasts and all that, your kanalta ceremonies, those type of things, they were all made criminal under this section here. Dances, some of the Plains tribes, they have sun dances, those type of things. They're all made illegal under this. And then after that, you can see at number 5, it says plural marriage. Supposedly, because Indians were placed on reservations, that the men had more than one wife, or they gathered wives so that they could, you know, their rations could be increased, is what it's saying. So what it says is, we need to do away with plural marriages. Having more than one wife is what it is. So that was outlawed. So you have more than one wife, you were charged with an offense, a crime, under the course of Indian offenses. If you read through these and you look at what kind of punishment, after conviction, what kind of punishment was meted out to these people, you will see in there where it says withholding of rations or denial of rations. That's what it says. And what does that mean? It means starving people into compliance with these rules. They were willing to starve the Indian people, to strip them of their cultures and everything, deny them food. That's what it is. And it's set out right in these rules here. And then, of course, the next one one of my favorites is number six. What it says is, the usual practices of so-called medicine men shall be considered Indian offenses. Your whole ceremonies, all of those different ceremonies that you have, Pujonji ceremonies at that time, there were a lot of ceremonies. Medicine men practicing those were charged with offenses under this code here. Now think about that. There is such a thing called the First Amendment under the United States Constitution, right? United States Constitution has a provision in there which says that you have the right to religion. You have the right to religion, practice whatever religion you want. You have that right in the United States Constitution. And the federal government can't deny that. Can't deny that to you. But think about it. Why is it that the federal government itself puts into these laws, making it a crime for Indian practice, to practice their Indian people, to practice their own religions? That's what it is. It's denial of religious freedom. That's what it is. At the time, no one stood up and said, hey, wait a minute, you're a federal government. What you're doing here is you're violating the rights of people, Indian people, to practice their religion. No one said that. You can see that the double standard that is going on here. The federal government has complete control to do whatever it wants to Indian people, to Indian tribes. Federal government can deny constitutional rights to Indian people, to Indian tribes, and still get away with it. You see that? There are certain federal laws that were passed, like the Major Crimes Act. They're very questionable whether they are constitutional or not. These same regulations and the creation of the Court of Indian Offenses itself was challenged. Indian people charged under these provisions here challenged these and said, what the government did here, the Bureau of Indian Affairs did here, is unconstitutional, is what they argued. And then the federal court says, no, these are not really federal laws. These are just BIA regulations. And the Bureau of Indian Affairs can do whatever it wants to civilize the Indians. This is all part of the civilizing program, is what the court said. So we find out that they say, constitutional or not, it doesn't matter. You'll find in some of these early court decisions involving Indian tribes where the federal government has passed certain laws and it has been challenged under the U.S. Constitution, and the United States Supreme Court will evade that constitutional argument and come back around and say, these laws are good because it's part of the civilizing process. The government civilizing the Indians is what it will say. So you can see that if these same kind of rules, regulations, laws are passed for people who we call non-Indians, other American citizens, if these were applied to them, the courts would hold them, these laws, unconstitutional. But if they're applied to Indian people, they evade it. They don't hold these laws unconstitutional. So that's where you have this thing, this theory, that certain laws dealing with Indian people that regulate the lives of Indian people are extra constitutional. They go beyond the Constitution itself, where the court says, we're not going to look at a constitutional argument, really. This is just something that is necessary to civilize the Indians. So you can see some of those cases decided by the United States Supreme Court that does that. So then we have here a law that makes practicing your religion illegal, makes it a crime. And of course, you can see what they're saying about medicine men. Here it talks about in the letter, it says in here, another great hindrance to the civilization of the Indians is the influence of the medicine men, who are always found with the anti-progressive party. who is the anti-progressive party? The traditionalists, right? The people who are traditionalists. In the old days, you had people who were traditional and then people who were called progressives. The progressives are the ones that accepted civilization and all that on these reservations. And the people who are called anti-progressives were the ones that were traditionalists, practiced their religion, all that type of stuff. So you had this conflict on reservations between two groups of Indian people. So here it says the medicine man always hangs out with the anti-progressive party. And of course, you know today who hangs out with the medicine men, the medicine people. The New Agers, right? You know, all these quiet people that come over and then they want to learn stuff from the Indians, so they hang out with the medicine men. Well, in the old days, it was illegal to be a medicine man and to hang out with a medicine man. So that's what it says. And then later on it says, the medicine man used all these arts, sounds like witchcraft, you know, from Salem witch hunt. They used all these arts and everything to keep the people under their influence, is what it says. And also they use whatever, you know, trickery, magic, whatever it is that they have to keep the children out of schools, is what they're saying. So they come up with all these things, and then later on they call the medicine men, you know, they can, you know, give out certain remedies, herbs and stuff like that, but they're really imposters, is what they're saying. So your herbalist or whoever it is, you go to the, get your medicine from the herbs and all of that, they call those people imposters. And they said they're comparing them to physicians. They said, we have physicians for these agencies and all that, and here it is, these imposters are running around prescribing herbs and all that type of stuff. And what it really does is it injures the people themselves, is what they're saying. And then you can look at that. So it's all set out in there. And then, of course, then we can move on to the next one. And number 7, of course, is about property. Now, in some Indian tribes, when someone passes away, what a family will do is they gather the property, right? And then they have the gathering, and then they give the property away. The property of the person who is deceased, and then also other property of the family, they give it away. That's part of their culture, part of tradition. In Navajo, in traditional times, what we would do is, someone passed away, then we would gather their property, clothes, whatever property they had, and they would burn them. They were burned in the old days. And so that's what they're talking about, their practices. The burial practices, mourning practices, all of these. They said that Indians do those things, then what they're really doing is they're destroying their property. And then we have to teach them about the value of property. Property, of course, is a very integral part of European culture. Property, especially title to land. Land considered as property is very, very central to European ways of dealing with stuff, Western ways of society, owning property, individual property ownership. So here it is, they're saying what these Indians are doing is they're just destroying their property, and we have to teach them the value of property, is what they're saying. So that is also made a crime. And then we move on to the next one there, and it talks about what it really is dowry. But they're saying that any Indian who pays money to the family of a girl or whatever it is to cohabit with that girl shall be charged with an offense. What they're talking about is dowry. You know, in Navajo culture, what we have is, you know, the uncle rides off into the early morning dawn, and then you don't know where he's going, but he's looking for a wife for his nephew, right? In the old days, it was the uncle who had the authority, the obligation to find a wife for his nephew. And so he's out there and then takes his jewelry and goes visit certain families and makes those offerings and stuff. And then the family accepts. And then they come over, the man's side of the family goes over there, and then they present dowry, right? They present jewelry, whatever it is, baskets and all that. That's what they're talking about. And that is also outlawed by these regulations. They call that buying Indian women, is what they call it, but it's really dowry. I mean, now it's not only Indian tribes that do that as part of their culture, This is done all over the world. Indigenous peoples, different parts of the world, dowry is one of the ways that the practice, that's part of the practice for marriages. So this is what they're talking about. And then, of course, at number 9, you have a catch-all. This is a catch-all. It's a misdemeanor provision. It's a catch-all. So you are doing anything that's being an Indian, you are charged with a crime. That's what it is. That's being yourself, you know, charged with a crime. And this is the misdemeanor division. They say that what you're doing is you're not working, you're just loafing, then you get charged with a crime. Or else, you know, you're going out there and then you're gathering herbs, whatever it is, you're charged with a crime. This is what that provision does. Anything having to do with Indian culture, doing anything related to Indian culture, you were charged with a crime under the misdemeanor provision. So those are the original rules that came out in 1883. And then in 1882, they were revised, but most of it, the heart of it, the core of it, remain in those 1892 regulations. And then, of course, who were the judges for these courts of Indian offenses? The judges came from the Progressive Party. Qualifications for being a judge is you had to wear citizen's dress. That means that you can't run around wearing buckskin and all that. You have to wear citizen's dress. And the next thing is that you can't be engaged in plural marriage. If you only had one wife, then you qualified as a judge. So the agency superintendent was the one who appointed the judges to these courts. Courts of Indian offenses. Of course, how did this affect us? It came to us in 1892. And so, but the Navajo judges did something. What they did is, they had these rules in front of them, but what they really did is they used Navajo custom law, customary law. When they made these decisions, when people came before them charged with these crimes, what they did is they applied Navajo customary law. And the Indian agent didn't know anything about it, so the Navajo system kind of went underground. But they were using customary law, Navajo ways of solving problems, no dispute resolution, what we call peacemaking today. That's what they were doing. And they had a form sheet on there had disorderly conduct on it. And so what they would do is people were charged with crimes, would come in and all that, and then they solved the case, and they used this form. All of them had disorderly conduct on them. They just put a person's name on there, and whatever it is, they write it, and they turn it over to the Indian agent, BIA agent, and they thought that the person was, you know, coming out with all these punishment and sentences and all that, but it was all done with using customary law, custom law. That's what they did. And they kept it hidden from the Indian agents. Now, the Navajo Courts of Indian Offenses continued on until 1959. In 1953, Congress passed a law called Public Law 280. And what that did is, it authorized 5 states to take jurisdiction over Indian reservations within those states. Arizona was not one of them. And then they have what they call optional states. Optional states, they can assert jurisdiction over on Indian reservations. Their legislative body had to pass laws to do that. And so what they did is the state of Arizona, the legislature down in Phoenix, started talking about asserting jurisdiction over the Navajo Nation. Paul Jones at the time was the chairman. And so what they did is they called on their lawyers, told them about it, not lawyers that are advising the Navajo Nation, told them what was going on. So Paul Jones and a number of council delegates went down to Phoenix to make an opposition to that. And they were told when they got there that their opportunity to speak before the legislative body would come. So they had them waiting in the lobby. And they sat there and sat there and sat there, and they never went in, never allowed them to say anything. And then what they did, I guess, is they said in there that, you know, there's some Navajos here and they're opposed to it, so we better not pass this legislation, is what happened. So then they came back over here, the Council of Delegates and Paul Jones and all those folks, and they said, what we really need to do is we need to take control of our own court system. We also need to take control of our own police department. So the first thing they did is they took control of the police department. It came the Navajo Nation Police. They took it from the Bureau of Indian Affairs. And then the next thing they did is they passed a resolution that took the court system, the former Navajo Courts of Indian Offenses, and turned it into the Navajo Nation court system. The judges that were still sitting as CFR judges in the Navajo system, their terms expired on April 1st. And so what they did is they turned them into Navajo Nation judges on April 1st, 1959. The resolution was passed in, I think it was October 1958, but they made it so it was effective on April 1st, 1959. You know what April 1st is, April Fool's Day, right? Well, anyway, so that's the day that it became effective. So the former CFR judges became Navajo Nation judges. So that's how the Navajo Nation took control of its court system. And there is also a case that was going through the court system all the way up to the United States Supreme Court called Williams versus Lee. And if you ever get a chance to read that decision, read it. It's where a traitor sued a Navajo couple, the Williams, in state court. And the state court held that it had jurisdiction over Navajo Nation, Navajo transactions in Navajo country. Case went all the way to the United States Supreme Court. United States Supreme Court reversed the Arizona Supreme Court decision and ruled that if you have a non-Indian who enters into a contract or a transaction with an Indian on reservation, then state courts have no jurisdiction, no power over that. It is an issue that belongs in the tribal courts. In that case, it belongs in the Navajo courts, is what the United States Supreme Court ruled. And in there, it talks about the Navajo Courts of Indian Offenses. It's that the Navajo Courts of Indian Offenses is doing very well, all that kind of applause. It, in there's some language in there. So if you ever have a chance to read that decision, read it. Called Williams versus Lee. I think Mrs. Williams is still alive. She's probably in her 90s now. It's over there from the Ganado area. I don't know. She must have passed away. But that was her case. It was over sheep, is really what it was. What she did is she went to the trading post and all that, and she made, bought stuff on credit. That's what they used to do in the old days, bought stuff on credit. And then she wouldn't pay it off. So the trader had the Arizona Apache County Sheriff come in and confiscate her sheep. And so while this case was going all the way up to the United States Supreme Court, the sheep were sitting in a pen over there in St. John's. They were there when the sheriff was feeding the sheep. There was a case was going to the United States Supreme Court. So that's where it was. Anyway, so if you have a chance, read that decision. But taking over the Navajo court system, the police functions and all that, was in response to Public Law 280. The Navajo Nation Council of Delegates officials didn't want state jurisdiction. That's why they started this court system. So now we have the Navajo Nation court system. It's operation now. And one of the things that the court system is emphasizing a lot now is use of customs and traditions as law. You heard about fundamental laws and all that. That's all part of that. So using our own laws, cultures, traditions, and all that to decide cases. I think that's great because what you're doing is you're doing Navajo sovereignty the Navajo way. Of course, there are people who disagree with me, even Navajos. They say, what's this fundamental law business? We don't want it, you know. We don't want to be like the states or the feds. You know, there are people that have that kind of idea also. Myself, I think it's a great, you know, great thing that we're doing, that we're using our own culture, our own customs, our own tradition, that stuff that you're learning here as part of your DNEP policy and all that that you have here at this school. You know, that's part of it. And I think that's a way to practice Navajo sovereignty. Navajo is doing sovereignty the Navajo way, using their own thinking and all that. So that's what that is. I'm getting close to here. And then now, there's also what we call peacemaking. In the old days, before the courts of Indian offenses, the courts of Indian people solved their disputes according to their own ways, traditional ways, and Navajo did the same thing too. And they had what they call, what we call peacemaking now. They had something that, similar to that. Peacemaking, from what the elders say, from elders told me, is part of Hojongji ceremony. That's what it was. It comes from Hojongji ceremony, peacemaking, solving disputes. So that was the way that they solved disputes in the old days. So in the 1980s, I think it was the maybe late 1970s or 1980s, court system, the Navajo courts, the judges wanted to see what the Navajo people thought about the Navajo courts, the adversarial system that you see where you have the judge sitting up there in a black robe. They wanted Navajo people see what they thought about that. And when the results came back, the Navajo people said, we don't like that stuff at all. This was somewhere in the late 1970s or 1980s, I don't remember when it was. What people were saying is, we go to Blackstaff or whatever it is, we go over there and we got charged with a crime. And then we brought before a judge, and here it is, there's a white judge sitting up there. And you may be giving up someone to defend you before that court. And who do they give you? They give you a white lawyer as your defense counsel. And who is the person prosecuting you? There's a white person there prosecuting you. And you have a jury trial. Who's sitting up there? Nothing but white people trying to determine your fate. And who is there? The only brown person, the only dark person in that whole courtroom. And we don't like that. That system that they use over there in Flagstaff or off the red somewhere is the same system that you guys are using on us here in Navajo Nation. That was the response. And so the judges started thinking and said, hey, what we need to do is we need to come up with something different. And then people came back, talk about peacemaking. But we hadn't had peacemaking in a long, long time, officially, really. And so then the people started talking about it. They went back to the elder. And they said, this is how it used to be done and all that. And so then they formalized peacemaking. That became Navajo peacemaking. Now, Navajo peacemaking, there are comparisons I put down for you. Which is this sheet here says peacemaking comparisons. On top, from 1 to 19 on top, is the court system. That's the adversarial system. What you see in state courts and federal courts and also the formal Navajo court system. Below is that one compares to one over here. Down here, then below, the group below is Navajo peacemaking, and you can see the comparison. One, in the court system, you have what is called hierarchies of power. You have start with your case down here in the trial court. You lose, you go to court of appeal, you lose, and then you may go to the state Supreme Court. You lose, and then you want to go to the United States Supreme Court, and you go there and you lose. It takes you 15 years or so. Finally, you got to the last step and you still lost, and you're already out $100,000 paying lawyers and fees and travel expenses, all that type of stuff. It costs a lot of money. Under Navajo Nation court system, you go to the formal court system, it's the same way. It costs too much. The Navajo Nation Council and BIA, government funds, they fund the Navajo Nation courts at something that, I don't know, $8 million or $10 million a year is how much they give the court system to operate that court system. The adversarial system is very, very expensive to operate. If we all went back to peacemaking, where the most of our cases go into peacemaking, had there be money left over to give to the next college? But what is going on is it's eating up all the money over there, the court system. Now, peacemaking, the cost for it is only $60 per case. That's it. You get a peacemaker, you come together before a peacemaker, and you talk about the problem. You have an opportunity to talk about the problem, an opportunity to help solve the problem yourself. That's what it's about, doing things the old way. I hear some people saying, well, I don't want to go to peacemaking because the peacemaking is related to that person. Oh, that means this relation or that relation. The whole purpose behind peacemaking is to get somebody sitting there who's related to you so that you behave yourself in front of your relative. Yeah, that's what peacemaking is. To have your peacemaker there who's related to you right from your community. who can shake their finger at you with that lesson say, you know, what you did is wrong, now you two talk this thing out and iron this thing out. That's how peacemaking is done. That's how it was done in the old days. See, but now what people say is, well, the peacemaker is not impartial. We are so much indoctrinated, brainwashed with Western ways of doing things that we think that, you know, American way or Western way is better than our own way. It is not. It is just one way of doing things. Navajo way is another way of doing things. All the different parts of the world, people have different ways of doing things, and they're all good. It fits within those cultures. Navajo, we have the same thing. Peacemaking, traditional way of doing stuff, fits within our culture. Our language pertains to those, it comes from them. Our religions, our faith, all of these is tied directly to those, all of those. Our identity, just gave you my plans and all that, it's related to that. It's all that, that's what it is. So that's what peacemaking is, and you can look at it and the comparisons here. And I remember, before I start for questions, well, if you can think about this, now the adversarial system, the court system, where you are disputing with someone, A versus B, you go into court, and then A has a lawyer and B has a lawyer over here, and you're just sitting there really saying nothing, and your lawyers are going at each other, right? Using rules of procedures and all that type of stuff, and you're just sitting there. And then all of a sudden the judge makes a ruling and all that. I've seen cases where Navajo elders are sitting in the room, traditional people are sitting in the room, and the case is going on, and grandma is raising her hand way back there. And then the judge says, you can't say anything because you're not a party to the case. Only these people question, okay, yes, they can talk about this with their lawyers, but you are not a party. That's why we have this bar here that bars you, keeps you out in the back. See, grandma back there is raising her hand. Frustrated and leaves. See, that's what happens. That's what the adversarial system is. And then here it is, one side wins the case, judge rules or juror rules in that person's favor. And then there they go out into the lobby, they're jumping up and down, slapping, high-fiving each other. We won the case and all that stuff going on. And then the other side dragging their tail, heads down, walking out the courtroom. And then later on, you're down at Bashers. And here it is, they're arguing right down there in the milk section and the meat section. They're arguing with each other. That's the adversary system. You have solved this case on paper. The judge has signed off on it, but you have not solved the problem. Parties are still fighting with each other. The young people are fighting with each other, and the relatives are fighting with each other, arguing with each other. After the case is supposed to have been finished, see? But in peacemaking, you bring in your family. You bring in grandma, grandfathers, and aunts and uncles, bring them in. You over here, you bring them in too. And we'll all sit together like this in this room, and we'll talk about it, and we'll discuss it to death, and then we'll come up with a solution. That's what peacemaking is, and that's how things were done in the old days. So that is why they court system brought peacemaking back. See? So you can read it on your own.